ordered to, you know, get it back from the moon. And if you make enough wrong assumptions, you can prove anything is impossible.
Sure. But, I mean, even you got to admit, I mean, he comes out and says, yeah, never, it's not going to happen. Not going to happen. And then all of a sudden, oh, yeah, okay, we can do it. It's like, really? It's, even Scotty doesn't say stuff like that. He'll at least play it out. It's like, okay, maybe.
Where did he say that, incidentally?
Writing in Conquest of the Moon, and I will have to look up exactly where the first publication was because I just cut and pasted.
Well, how long ago is what I'm...
Oh, it was in the 50s.
60s? You know,
50s. 50s. 1950s. Yes, and I know that was before, you know, everything was getting up there. But even he had his doubts. And I got to throw one. Hey, by the way, have you ever seen – I got to throw this out here as a tidbit, a little shout-out to my friend Jonathan, who I'm sure would love me mentioning it. And that is have you ever seen Wernher von Braun's headstone?
No.
On it. Very simple headstone. You would have thought that the father of rocket science, you thought he would be a big – cement thing, him pointing towards the stars, looking off into the distance. You would have thought something like, no, simple headstone, Wernher von Braun, 1912 to 1977, and it says on it, Psalm 19:1. That's all it says. Doesn't say what the verse is, so you have to look it up. And the verse says, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Why in the world would the father of rocket science be talking about a structure that was described in Genesis, I'm sorry, initially first described in Genesis, but then in Psalms. Why would he talk about this? Why would that be his call out from the grave? Of all the verses.
Does the word firmament doesn't mean something solid? The sky is the firmament.
Well, it depends where you're looking at. I mean, Genesis says it's solid enough to separate the waters from the waters, and I don't want to go into chapter and verse too much. This isn't a religious broadcast.
No.
But it raised an eyebrow when I saw it because I was going, why would he have a Bible verse on there? First of all, there's not a lot of scientists I know that are going to put Bible verses on their headstones. I mean, I know there's some sentiment there, you know, when, you know.
Usually they don't have a choice in the matter. Somebody else does it for them because they're gone.
Well, sure. But it's an interesting passage because I you know, the guy was, you know, kind of a mystery in some ways. I think, and it comes back to what we were looking at here, and that is when you said, you know, that you co-authored a book called, I'm sorry, it was called Science Is Wrong, or Science Was Wrong.
Science Was Wrong. Yeah.
Science Was Wrong.
What we originally titled it, you'll like this, was It's Impossible, Isn't It?
Nice.
But the publisher changed it.
What if... Again, I know I'm not going to – look, I know that you've been set in your beliefs for a long time. But man, I'm not going to try to convince you in a show because it's almost impossible. Anybody that goes through what everyone in the movement's going through, it takes days if not weeks to try to get your head around it. No play on words there. But isn't it possible that if the United States and the Soviet Union back in the 50s figured out – that the world that they were taught, maybe they had maps, you know, again, I go to the Admiral Byrd. Do you know who Admiral Byrd is, by the way?
Yes, of course.
Okay. The, what if, you know, because in 1950s.
I watched an astonishing interview with him and it was in, like, maybe it was in your movie. I don't know.
Yeah. The Longines Chronoscope interview.
Yes.
From a CBS affiliate. We were lucky to get it, where he comes on television and he says, look, Antarctica is made out of money. He goes, there's everything you could ever want there.
Yeah.
And then 2 years later, they're all leaving the ice like they're on fire. Like they could not get off fast enough. And then they seal the sucker down and it's locked down from all corporations for all time. So the question is, I'm throwing the possibility out at you because, you know, you seem like a pretty open-minded guy. And that is, if they figured out that the maps they were using for hundreds of years were wrong, and they were wrong about all the science about the geography of the world itself was wrong, would they tell people? And furthermore, could they hide it if they compartmentalized it well enough? And that's where I kind of, you know, that was my big turning point where I said, you know what? If I was them, I might actually try to do the same thing. Because I think, you know, the population is not going to do well with this. Religion is certainly going to have a field day with us. So why not? And so my question to you is, is it feasible at all for, you know, if again, if they saw the true shape of the world, or a shape that certainly didn't fit what they've been passing off for all these years, do you think they'd have the capability of hiding it or the motivation?
I don't know. I'm trying to decide what people can or will or would want to cover up. You got all kinds of targets for that notion.
Yeah.
And the whys, too, for that matter. But, you know, don't you think if we faked the moon landings, that the Russians would have made a noise?
No, because I think the Russians were there. They were on the ice with us down during Operation Deep Freeze in 1955 to 1956. And I think we brought them in on it because they were the biggest other player after World War II. You know, England was still rebuilding and the rest of the world was kind of in chaos. And yeah, Russia was still burning. But I think I don't think we could do it by ourselves. And I think we brought them in and we learned the space, the rocketry program together. And I think the Cold War was a complete sham and that we have been secret brothers since the beginning at the highest levels. I mean, yeah, we tell our troops, you know, better dead than red and all that other fun stuff. But I think at the highest levels, Russia knows. And that's the reason why their space program really wasn't done with as much enthusiasm after a while, because it's like, you know, the Americans got a handle on how they're passing off space and we don't want to get involved. And Great Britain, I think, at the highest levels, they knew. And they said, you know what? We don't want a piece of this at all. Because,
well, I can understand England not wanting a piece of it. They didn't have enough money to use for it.
England was
in pretty bad shape.
You know, the first guy they put in, he went up yesterday, 2015, end of 2015. That was the first Briton apparently to ever do anything in space. It's a long time.
Well, I live in Canada. We were a colony of Britain for a long time. But yeah. The Brits have a long history of ego before performance.
Sure.
Remember Dunkirk?
Yeah.
The history of developments before the Second World War, an English guy invented a jet engine, but nobody would pay any attention to him. So yeah. Who flew the first jet aircraft? The Germans did. And then that guy went to work at Wright-Patterson Air Force.
Yeah,
go
figure. quick question for you. If it's too personal, let me know. Are you religious in any capacity?
Well, I was. Let's put it that way.
Okay, but because
I grew up, my family was Orthodox Jewish, and I didn't eat non-kosher meat until I was 16, I guess.
Okay. But
I'm not a practicing anything at this point in time.
Okay.
So.
Well, that's okay because you'll understand this though, and that was because you were asking part of the reason why. You know, why would you try to cover up something like that? And I covered this in one of the clues where I said, look, you know, the big five religions in the world, which is Judaism, Buddhism, Hinduism, Islam, and Christianity, make up, 80% of the population.
Well, Jews are a very small percentage of that.
Well, you know, but it's still considered a very significant group, you know, and yes. You can't take them out of the big five.
Jesus was Jewish. What the heck? We got to give the Jews credit for something.
Good, good enough. All these groups have been looking for thousands of years, been looking for some validity for their faith, something concrete, the Holy Grail, the Ark of the Covenant. You know, the spirit of destiny. Take your pick. You know, everyone's looking for some magical, wonderful artifact. If we are living in a structure, in a physical structure with barriers, a barrier you can walk up to and maybe not see, but definitely touch or at least feel some part of it, would that not imply divine purpose? You know, intelligent design. And wouldn't you simultaneously be giving all these religions their holy grail at the same time? And for a power structure, especially in the 50s, you know, suit and ties and IBM guys and, you know, all these major defense contractors, you're talking about rolling the dice on a very big table, and you don't know how that's going to turn out. You know, what would religion do if they figured out that science was wrong? Not necessarily hiding from it, because now it's amplified, because now not only were they wrong, but now it seems like they're hiding it as well. that would be...
Religion is certainly one of the reasons for a cover-up, if you will. Pat Robertson has said every intelligent person in the galaxy is on planet Earth, and it was created in 4004 BC. And so he'd be totally tossed out as, you know, giving a false notion of where we fit, where we are, what's going on. Yes,
exactly. And my point was that if that happened, science would take a beating for a while. They would actually just take a shellacking, because religion would go back and say, look, we knew this the whole time. And you guys, you know, because it is in all the texts, you know, in one way or another, you know, even non-canon.
I'm worried, again, you're going back to firmament being a structure.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering where translations and so forth fit in here. Because
I don't
consider the sky a structure in that sense.
It's not even just the structure and the Christian community, and unfortunately I am lax in that department. I mean, yeah, I was raised born again Christian and Sunday school and Bible camp and the whole nine yards, but they have latched onto this thing very enthusiastically because of a lot of other stuff. And I'm not going to quote a lot of chapter and verse. If you want, you can go to like testingtheglobe.com by Rob Skiba. He did a really nice job, which was a lot of passages. The earth is fixed over and over again. The earth is fixed, immovable. The story of Joshua, how he asked for God to keep the sun in the sky an extra day. The Tower of Babel, which makes no sense on a spinning globe in a solar system, but makes perfect sense if it's in an enclosed structure that's not moving at all. And just over and over again, these passages. So it's not just the structure. I mean, yeah, it starts out in Genesis with the structure, but it's just one aspect.
Remember, Newton wasn't born until long after Genesis was written. So
that is
Kepler,
true.
That is true.
And I'm not saying these guys, because people have asked me, they said, look, you know, you're not smarter than Einstein or Hawking or any of these guys. I'm going, no, of course not. But what if
they found Newton and Kepler? That's how we explain the periods of the planets and all that sort of stuff.
But okay, then what if their foundations were wrong? What if the old structures that we built the globe model on were flawed, and every scientist from then until present day have been just unfortunately mistaken? I feel bad for astrophysicists that have just finished their thesis, because there's nothing I can do for them. There's no way I can convince them, you know, if this thing comes out, and by that I mean when. They're just going to, you know, crawl into a corner in a fetal position because they're not going to know what to do. I'm saying the cover-up at the highest level was easy, and the rest of the stuff – was hard, but the rest of the stuff came easy. The scientists, they're always going to do their work based on other people's work. So if people say, oh, yeah, there's a solar system, here's the solar system dynamics, people are just going to keep basing – you know, but the foundation is fragile. And if that
I think our knowledge of the solar system has enabled us to send devices, I'll call them satellites, but maybe that's as good as anything, to a number of other places.
Yes.
You know, the Cassini. I like the Cassini because it was really neat that we headed it toward Venus and then back to Earth and get a free kick each time. And then
sure.
Past Jupiter and get a free kick, and there it is mucking around near Saturn.
But
that's kind of neat stuff.
Okay, I'm going to try a different track.
Are you saying it's all phony?
I'm saying that the people that told you that there were satellites are also the same people that told you that we went to the moon, and that there's a space station up there called the ISS. And so I come back to you, and this will make more sense. And this is really for the people listening. And that is, if you had to go out and tell the person, the average person on the street, time and money is no object here, how would you prove to them that they are on a globe?
I'd probably take them on a trip, and I can't remember their names, the people who flew an airplane all the way around the planet. Remember that?
Just like a worldwide trip? That's how you do it?
Well, I'm saying that's nonstop around the globe. Remember that?
Yeah, I remember. Yeah, you take a jump.
I can't remember their names, and I should, but I'm getting
but
old.
Just because you move a race car around a round dining room table doesn't mean that the dining room table is a sphere. It just means that you drove.
I didn't say it did, but they seemed to get where they were going. And
good point.
You know.
Okay, but is there any other thing you
and the
would
sun set and rose, you know, it's a funny way to put it, but
sure,
they went through dark areas and then back to the light.
Yeah,
is there implies that there's some round there going around. Oh,
sure, at least from a distance in a circular way, but as far as a sphere goes, a globe goes, is there anything
else?
How
can you go around something if it's flat?
You
go
just
off in one direction and come back and around and go back to your original starting place.
How do you remove your finger around a dinner plate? You're going around in a big circle. You're not going around a sphere, though. And if the circle is big enough, how would you know? And you'd say, well, GPS would tell us. I was going, you mean the same GPS that was created by the Department of Defense, United States military, those
no,
guys?
No, I wouldn't have referred to the GPS. I would refer to the guys who go around the planet nonstop. Which is kind of a neat trick. And you don't think the space station,
the International Space Station. No, I do not. And I was a fan of the ISS. I helped, gotta remember, man, I tried to debunk this. I tried to shoot this thing down for a better part of a year. And when I got to the ISS, and it wasn't me who made the video, look up ISS hoax on YouTube if you get a chance. It is fascinating. The interior footage of the ISS is from a production standpoint. Just from a, you know, I watch a lot of media, I watch a lot of movies and television shows, and the interior shots are horrible. From because you're looking at it and everything should be fine. Remember, this is real life. So movie mistakes and movie bloopers, you shouldn't be able to find them in real life. You shouldn't be able to find them on the news, and we are finding them over and over again. There is no reason.
Well, are you saying there is no space station going around?
I'm saying there may be something flying up there, but there's no people in it. Not by a long shot. And that,
so you've got all these people lying.
Well, yeah, but these guys are different from the Apollo people, because these people, they're just Air Force employees. And you know this. I mean, you make them sign you give them a clipboard with a non-disclosure agreement. They sign whatever they want. You say, look, you're going to fake this. You don't get to ask why. But you're going to fake it. Then you're going to fly around in your khakis and your polo shirt and your socks, even though there's apparently no danger to worry about. And
you're making it. You're spreading the circle of lies awfully large. And I have real trouble with that.
How large do you need it?
I know some of the astronauts. And you're saying that all of these guys have lied. Not just some of them. All of them. Right.
Anyone involved in NASA. NASA is a complete fraud, in my opinion, from top to bottom, although there are a lot of people in NASA that don't know it. So the people that are on camera, yeah, there's only like, what, 500 of them that have ever been on camera that have supposedly been in space. The people that do the telemetry data, yeah, the software guys, they know. There's select others, but the people that turn wrenches, no. No, not by chance. What, my next-door neighbor, I lived with for a year out in Boulder, Wayne Ottinger. He was one of the guys that built the LEM, the lunar module, the first one. You know, the one that kind of blew up when, I can't remember if it was Buzz or Neil, when they were testing with the ejector seat. He built that. His walls were bristling with plaques. He didn't know anything. He couldn't have been prouder to work for NASA. But because really, he's a garage mechanic. What's he gonna know? What do you tell him? You know, you don't have to tell him anything. But yes, at the highest levels, yes, NASA is a fraud. Anybody that has to do anything with the telemetry that has to do with Pioneer or Voyager or the Galileo series, any of that stuff.
See, I have real trouble with that, besides having met some of these people.
I'm not saying they're bad
people. I've worked on classified programs, and I can understand that, and there's some big ones.
Sure.
You know, that were kept secret for, well, our first, the Corona spy satellite, 30 years before we admitted it. And there were 12 failures at the beginning of it that were never publicly discussed.
I'm saying, if you're friends with some of these guys, great. I'm saying that I don't believe, and which is why I think, you know, Neil and a lot of the Apollo guys went into hiding was, and by the way, I don't have a doubt in my mind of crap, can't remember the name, the guy that died on the pad, Gus Grissom. I have no doubt that he was made an example of, because, you know, they told him, you know, I think these guys were absolutely legit. I think they were heroes. I think they were Boy Scouts. And I think when they went to him, they said, look, we know you've been training, but it's not going to happen. And here's why. And I think it weighed very high, you know, very heavy on him. Look at the Apollo 11 international press conference. Those guys should have been higher than kites. They should have been beaming from ear to ear, just lucky to be back. And they, I've never seen such sullen faces. Neil looked like he wanted to crawl underneath the desk. Those guys, and they, I think the powers that be learned from that mistake. And that was, you know what, we're not going to tell any astronauts anything about why. We're just going to tell them, look, you're doing this for God and country. You're going to sign that agreement and you're going to go from there. Do I think they wanted to lie? Do I think these people are awful, awful people? No. I think they're doing it for what they consider to be the greater good.
Well, okay. Let me go back to something I asked about. The the seismometer on the moon and the moonquakes and stuff, and also the rocks that were brought back. Now, you're saying petrified wood. I'm not saying there aren't phony moon rocks around. It would shock me if there weren't phony rocks, because how is somebody going to verify that what you just handed him wasn't a piece of junk, you know?
Yeah, some money to be made there.
Big money, yeah.
Big money. In fact, Interorbital out in California, they're selling moon rocks in advance before they even send anything up there. They're selling, I don't know, I think it was like $5,000-$7,000 a gram. And it was like, really? You guys have any? And you pay your money. You pay half your money up front with no refund in case something goes wrong. But I'll take you one further, and that is when it comes to the moon, I think I can simplify this, and that is if you get a chance, look up, because I can't watch the footage and not ignore – I can't ignore the footage that I've seen, and look up lunar waves on YouTube for anyone that wants to see it. And that is there's some amazing footage of the moon, which appears to be a refresh issue, a resolution issue that's going through the moon, and it is not the camera. And it doesn't make any sense. When I was looking at it, I knew exactly. I've been in tech long enough that I was looking. I was going, why is there a refresh issue with the moon? I was going, wait, why am I saying this? That's impossible. That means the moon, whatever we see on the surface of the moon, is a display. It is not the craters and everything. That's not really there. There's something underneath it that's actually displaying the moon. Whether it's two-dimensional or three-dimensional, that's up for debate. But I know that nobody landed on it. So...
Well, you believe that nobody landed on it.
I have more conviction than most, and I have yet to...
Like I say, having talked to a couple of the guys who were on the moon, who was the second man on the moon?
Buzz?
Aldrin.
Buzz Aldrin, yeah.
Yeah, I've done a couple of television shows. We were on the same show. We met, let's put it that way.
Sure.
It was Buzz that decked somebody who was thinking that he didn't go to
Bart Siebel, which was an interesting documentary. When astronauts astronauts gone wild in 2004, which was when he went to the astronauts again. Interesting. I think he completely stumbled upon us. I don't really like him much as an interviewer, but hey, he does what he does. But he brought out a Bible and he said, put your hand on it, swear that you went to the moon. These guys wouldn't touch it. They treated it like it was on fire. Why? It didn't make any sense. I was going, and it bugged me for years, because I was going, wait a minute. Why would they even care? One, they're not in a courtroom. They're not under oath anyway. It's just a Bible. It's not like you can't lie. It's called perjury. People do it all the time. So why wouldn't they do it? And I think there was a bigger purpose involved. I think that they knew at that point, because the whole concept of where we are and the spirituality of it and the concept of God comes in. And that is, are you really going to swear? It's one thing that was an analogy I've used before, and that is, it's one thing when you, to believe or not believe in Santa Claus. But it's another thing if you actually see him in the living room eating cookies. And that is, you really going to swear on the Bible against a God if you actually know what the world really looks like? Because if we are enclosed, then it's going to be real tough to be an atheist. Real tough. And at that point, you're accountable for everything. And I did
what I'm saying is, when people talk about conspiracies, you've got the biggest one possible going here, because it's not just the astronauts, but all the guys with all the signals coming back. You mentioned it before.
Yeah.
All the telemetry guys. And stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you're saying that Voyager didn't go out there or didn't go anywhere, I guess you're saying. And the Pioneer spacecraft.
Yep.
And you got a whole bunch of these things and a whole bunch of people who have kept the faith. That's a funny way to put it. you're saying they kept the faith, all right?
Yeah, so to speak, yeah.
And I have real trouble with that.
What, because of the sheer number of people?
The sheer number of people and the amount of sophistication to get all this stuff to come out fitting the wrong picture, if you will.
Well,
which is what you're saying, that all the measurements and everything have all been faked.
That's just it. When I looked at this, believe me, no one was a bigger fan of NASA than I was growing up. I thought they were the greatest thing ever. I mean,
well, whether NASA's, you know, I like I told you, I don't have much respect for NASA.
But what I'm saying is, they're as transparent as they are, there seems to be a lot of things missing. A lot should be stacks and stacks of evidence on the space side, which aren't there. Which I kind of talked about in the beginning. You know, the photos of Earth from space, 43 years, only one blue marble shot. You know, no shot. Even now, and NASA will says, "Oh yeah, we have no shot of the Earth rotating on its axis from space." And I do not count that Japanese geostationary satellite, which just sits there in one place, because that's not the Earth isn't rotating. They're getting lazy. No exterior.
But if you got an 8,000 mile diameter sphere, supposing one had,
yeah,
and you're within 100 miles of the ground. Doesn't matter whether it's 300 miles of ground.
Yeah,
you're awfully close, and you're not going to get a picture that shows it in space.
43 years. You're not talking about it. We're talking about a sought-after image. I wasn't kidding when I said that in 2000. This tells you how bad it was. That was only 15 years ago. In 2000, when I looked up, because I wanted pictures for all the I wanted different Earth pictures for all the monitors in my tech support department. And I looked, typed in Google, you know, Earth from space. The only picture that came up anywhere was the Apollo 17 shot showing, you know, the bottom part of Africa and all of Antarctica. It took years for them to even come up with CGI images to replace, you know, the guy from Apple that had to write, you know, the first iPhone globe that's on the front. He had to draw that because there were no images for him to get.
Well, what I'm trying to figure out is if you stick close to the planet, and maybe that's what you're saying, you won't be able to get those things.
We've got stereo behind, stereo ahead. You know full well we've got satellites that are way out there, if you believe in the NASA story. You can't tell me that none of them just spin around for a second and take a picture of themselves? Not to mention, we don't have satellites taking pictures of their other, and we don't even have a good consensus of how many satellites are in space. The numbers literally range from 3,000 to 20,000. Nobody knows. Nobody has any idea. You'd think that NASA would track everything in space, and apparently they track nothing. There's just so
why
many
would they track anything besides their own? Now the Department of Defense is another story.
Well, NASA still is, you know, as much as people want to call them, you know, the guys that are in the white uniforms that don't carry guns, they're still a military wing of the U.S. government. You know, they smile and they wave at the camera. But plus, I'll throw one more out at you, and that is, and I'll give credit to Max Malone. I mean, I didn't find all this stuff out. This is a hive mind operation where he goes, why is there no shot, no exterior shot of any astronaut from any distance on any mission where they even take the camera and moving camera, not still shots, moving camera and spin at least 180 degrees, not to mention a 360. It was never done on a space shuttle mission, Apollo, Soyuz, ISS. It's never been done. Why is that? Why is it never, ever? It would have happened on accident with all the thousands and thousands of hours of footage. It's never happened. And it's because they can't do it, because they're faking it. It is all a big ruse.
You're saying absence of evidence is evidence for absence, which I don't find.
You want to call it circumstantial? You know, you see footprints in the snow going up to a bank. You see broken glass, a few drops of blood, some bills, and some footprints going away. It doesn't take a rocket scientist. See what I did there? Rocket scientist to figure out what happened. You know, in this case, it's lack of, which is why I want to keep
circling
back.
That's what I just said, absence of evidence. That doesn't mean there's an evidence for absence, that there is no such thing. You haven't looked at all the pictures. Obviously, I haven't. But
all the pictures of what? The pictures of Earth from
saying
space.
There are no pictures that would meet the criteria of showing.
Well, that's just it, though. That's where I thought that I was making the mistake in the beginning. I was thinking someone's going to come back and say, oh, no, here they are right here. I even had a Jet Propulsion Laboratory call up during the show when I was doing Ground Zero. And Jet Propulsion Laboratory, why are they even listening to the show? And they call up and say, no, we got pictures. We'll send over to the station. They didn't send anything. I'm talking about the blue marble shot, Earth in full sunlight, full Earth. One shot was taken in 1972, and then for whatever reason, July of this year.
Where was it taken from?
Apollo 17. They waited till the last supposed mission coming back, and they took one shot of it coming back from Apollo 17, 1972. You know this photo better than anybody.
Well, wait a minute. Are you saying that Apollo 17 did go to the moon?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that shot was fake too. I'm saying that how they pass it off is that Apollo 17 supposedly took a shot. So Apollo 8 through 17, 10 missions, go to the moon, come back. Nobody takes any pictures of the Earth. On the last mission, where they know it was going to be the last mission, they come back and, oh, yeah, but let's take a shot just for posterity's sake, right? Supposedly take a shot. That was the only, you know, the only photograph they even put forward. And then, coincidentally, July of this year, they come out and NASA – what amazes me is they announced it. NASA puts it on their website. They say – oh, by the way, here's the second blue marble shot we've taken in 43 years. NASA they tweeted it. The White House retweets it. Obama, I've got a clip I'm going to put on my next show. Obama's talking about the blue marble shot. Nobody took notice of this. Basically, they confirmed everything that we were saying for the first 6 months, which is there's no pictures of the Earth from space. Oh, yeah, by the way, here's the second picture of the Earth from space. Really? 43 years? You didn't think of taking one?
Well, wait a minute. All the spy satellites are taking pictures of the Earth from space.
Not a full – yeah, spy satellites, okay. Spy satellites or spy planes? Because at this point, I'm questioning whether satellites are even there or if they're all being done by spy planes. If spy planes aren't taking the high-altitude shots and they're just passing off them as – they're just feeding that to the Google Earth database. And Google Earth, they're the ones that are running with it.
Yeah,
a lot of stuff.
What do we say about Google Earth? Where are those pictures taken from?
Google Earth? Oh, not very high up. You wouldn't need them to be very high up. You can
spot a house on a street, I guess. But
well, no. But I mean, even when you're going up, you don't. I mean, if a spy, let's say a spy plane, not the SR-71. We're assuming, even though the Air Force said that there's no other spy planes, that you know that the Aurora project doesn't exist. Let's say
I don't believe that either.
Well, thank you for giving me that one. Yeah. By the way, the little side note, because I watched the decommissioning, you know, on television of the SR-71, and when they asked the general, they said, "Oh yeah, what are you going to replace it with?" He goes, "Oh, nothing." It's going, what? Come on, you're really gonna? But anyway, so let's say a spy plane caps out at 20, 25 miles. That's pretty. That's way up there. And you can take some decent shots from there and stitch them together, and there you got Google Earth. Here's the thing, which is why I asked the question to you earlier, which was everything seems to be funneling through one group. Because when I ask this question, how would you tell the average person on the street, how would you show them that it's a globe? Eventually, they keep going back to one group, and that is NASA. You know, some sort of space organization. It's like, well, you can't show them unless you get up high enough to go into space. Like, really? You sure? There's other things you should be able to do. You know, the curvature going forward, you know, seeing in the distance, might be able to see that. But it's really, really tough. We've been so conditioned, you know, since grade school, you put a globe in our classroom. We don't know any different by the time we get out of high school, let alone your bachelor's, your master's, your PhD. So if you're trying to convince people, how do you show them? Because they automatically think, I get these two reactions all the time. They say, oh, we know it's a globe. Duh. Everybody knows it's a globe. And I go, well, how do you know it's a globe? We all know fires, you know, fire burns, water's wet. You drop a pen, you put a name to it that appears to be gravity, even though there's some question there. Then, but the globe is assumed like all these other things because you're just being told that it's a globe. What if it wasn't? What if
you're saying also that all the other planets, all the other planetary positions and so forth, that that's all baloney too, I think you're saying.
Yes, I'm saying that if you went into a planetarium and took pictures in a really nice planetarium and took pictures and fed them to people, what would they know the difference? Why?
Well, I'll even grant you that.
I mean, it's how much people will believe, especially nowadays. I'll give the here's an example for you, and that is I just thought of an absence of evidence thing for you, which was I show you a picture of me having dinner with Anne Hathaway, and I say, oh yeah, by the way, we've been dating for the last 10 years, and you come back and say, well, don't you have any more pictures than that? I go, no. But that's all you need, right? I mean, it's a picture. And it's like, yeah, but pictures can be faked. What's the difference between what we've been fed now and the Anne Hathaway story?
I think there's a hell of a lot more complex data when it goes to, Voyager, Viking, Pioneer.
Credibility, the subcontractors, General Dynamics, Lockheed, Boeing, Hughes Aircraft, all those guys, you know.
So they're being paid to fake everything.
No. They're turning wrenches. They're building stuff. Absolutely, they're building stuff. Those things are going nowhere. They're being fired up into the air. The telemetry is being taken over by the ATS, Department Atmospheric and Space Atmospheric and Transportation Safety Bureau, and which Interorbital told me about on a conference call, because I asked them, because I was suspicious. I said, look, you're going to send stuff up there. I go, but you have to file your flight plan with somebody like NASA, right? And they go, no, we don't have to do it with NASA. And then they mentioned this bureau, which I'd never heard of, which apparently that's who you'd contact 9 months at least in advance. You give them all your telemetry data, everything about the rocket, everything you need to know. You send up the rocket, they took over the telemetry, rocket falls in the ocean, nobody knows any different. They probably pipe it through the old, well, now it's going to be somewhat enhanced Loran system, and who would know any different? And they've kept a lid on this. And by the way, to your point, NASA has not done this well over the years. It has not aged well. All the stuff they've been doing, and some of their production techniques have been terrible, which is why it's being discovered now. The Internet hive mind, the detection ability of the Internet is awesome. They miss nothing. They don't miss mistakes.
But the amount of crap about conspiracies and so forth, there's an awful lot of false information.
You're absolutely right. But this one's different because this isn't one that you can bury underground in the Nevada desert and never, ever see again. This is something that we're actually living on. This was something that was never, in my opinion, my humble opinion, this was never something that was going to be hidden forever. They've had contingency plans for a while, and that is, you know, because you can't hide something that people are living on. It's like trying to hide something from your roommate. You can shift it around every once in a while. Sooner or later, they're going to find it. And they kept this thing going for 60 years. And the thing that really caught them was the high-speed internet and camera technology. Once you could put a computer into a camera, you could find a lot more. And the internet, not just social media, although that helps, but forms of social media. YouTube's really, really screwed them because people can compare notes anywhere. And that's what they've been finding. A guy in Nebraska at 3 in the morning can find this little thing. It's like, hey, this little thing on the ISS doesn't look right. Can everyone see this? Only takes one guy or girl. And that's where we are. We've been finding a lot of stuff. I mean, way too much stuff for it to be just conjecture and speculation. It's resonating too much, and it hasn't been shot down. The thing I like to say is it's like I was waiting for the silver bullet. Flat Earth is like a big old werewolf just running through the countryside, and people think they got the silver bullet to shoot it down, and they're not. It hasn't been shot down, and I'm trying to figure out why. It should have been shot down by now, and it's not. Nobody stepped forward. You would have thought that some physicist would have come forward and said, here's why it's absolutely 100% a globe, and here's my proof. And then people, if it would have resonated well enough, people would have said, you know what, completely mistaken, everybody was wrong, we all go home now. You know, they put down their pitchforks and their torches, and they go home, but they haven't. And that's why
there's an awful lot of people in the scientific community who won't be bothered with anything that's unusual. Don't want to pay attention to UFOs because it's impossible, and governments can't keep secrets, and a whole bunch of other false claims. But
true.
It keeps people away.
True.
Don't bother me with that crap.
I've read emails from physicists who are going, look, I don't know what's going on. Basically, they're really surprised more than anything, because the quote I had was, it's like, I don't know what's going on out there in the world, but I'm not going to go anywhere near it. But part of them is because, you know, and I've written to a couple of them, you know, anonymously, you know, they won't go on air, and they can't answer some of these questions. Some of the big ones, yeah, because they can throw out some math. Unfortunately, their only weapon in this is math. That's all they've got. You know, it's like, oh, okay, here's this, you know, the everything that has to do with a sphere. Here's all the math and trigonometry.
Well, I think the rocks back from the moon are more than math. And I'm not saying there aren't phony ones. I agree with you there.
Yeah,
but that doesn't mean there aren't real ones, too.
Again, it's just a rock. I picked up a rock on my way back from my dinner with Anne Hathaway. You know, and it was kind of crunchy looking. And I said, you know, I showed it to a museum guy. I said, yeah, I got it from the moon. Just because it comes from a military organization, and I have to circle back. It's like, look, I understand that people don't like being lied to, and especially from their own government. And, you know, but militaries do lie. Go back to the spy plane. Until the U-2 spy plane was shot down, we didn't have a spy plane. The SR-71 made it from conception to retirement. Nobody knew it was there. And then all of a sudden we come out and say, oh, by the way, we're retiring the SR-71 spy plane. It's like, what, you had a spy plane? And this, oh, you know what I mean.
People did know. Yeah, look, there's no question. There's a lot of, I'll call it fraud for want of a better word. It's a simple word to say deception, anything you want. I'm not saying that there hasn't been deception hither, thither, and yon. It's a way of life for some people. You're saying it's the only way of life for NASA and other organizations.
Yes.
But how about China and India going into space?
Oh, don't get me started on those guys. Because NASA was the first, every other space agency blueprinted and went through them. And yes, at the highest levels, from China, look up Chinese space bubbles. You get a chance on YouTube. Oh my, you thought our production levels were bad. They were downright sloppy. Let's put it this way. It's gotten so bad out there that NASA had to release a second wiki section called Third Party Confirmation of Moon Landings, which basically, because they've been just being battered over the last 5-10 years, and it basically says, look, don't take our word for it. Listen to China and India. And, you know, they say, okay, here's the picture that China took, or India. And, you know, China supposedly had a probe on the moon for the last since 2013. Nobody knows about this. It's like a Mars rover, supposedly on the moon, running around. It's like, why is it not the Sea of Tranquility? Why is it not taking a picture of the United States flag, walking up to it, snapping it in half, then unfurling the big red Chinese banner? Why are they not doing this or even talking about it? It's every space program has been blueprinted from NASA. NASA founded it. Russia was right there with them, and all the other space programs. We'll use the one from today.
Yeah, but Russia went into space first. They had the first satellite. They had the first man. They had the first woman. They had the first trip around the moon.
Yep.
And that's what led to NASA. All right.
Yep. But they got the head start. And I think at one point, unfortunately, we had Hollywood. We were better at than they were when it came to faking stuff. Russia's good. I mean, there's no question. In fact, I've got to watch the 1936 moon movie they did. I didn't even know exist, called Cosmic Journey. Apparently, it's very good. But they went up there, but once they realized that we could do it better, and by that I mean the U.S., for people that are out there and are not in the U.S., once they realized the United States could do it better, they just folded like a card table. Hey, doesn't that seem strange to you? By the way, because I've never seen this in the history of sports, and that is America, you know, big space race. We get to the moon. The United States gets to the moon. Russia just quits. Just gives up. It's like, that's it. They made it. That's it. Just pack it up. Pack it up. We're not going to do anymore. That's it. That's done. That never happens. That's like a marathon race, and the first person crosses the line. The other person just doesn't go to the race. You know,
Luna sent back some rocks.
Russia
sent back.
Why isn't Russia on the moon now? Why, what you said at the beginning of this thing, why don't we have a colony on the moon? We should have flying cars, which we can't, not if we're in an enclosed system. We should have Jetsons homes, and we should have a colony on the moon. I was a big fan of Space 1999, the television series. That thing seemed so logical and real. Why didn't it happen? And not only did it not happen, there's your absence right there. We never even, not even tried again to do anything. And then once other countries came online, why isn't China have a man on the moon? Why doesn't India, why didn't a woman ever go to the moon? What, to represent, you know, females? Why didn't that ever happen? It's none of this stuff happened. They've just been dragging their feet. The Orion program, I'm going to make a prediction right now.
Orion program do you mean?
The Mars mission. What they're doing now, getting ready for Mars. I know they're, you know, shooting up rockets and they're getting the capsule. I don't want to get into the Valen radiation belts right now. But the capsule, they're supposed to be going. Orion is supposed to go to Mars. Plain and simple. That mission is not going to happen. And it can't, because they realize they painted themselves into a corner. Their production techniques, if you're going to fake it, and I have not been shy about saying this in the past. If I was, say, working for the government and somebody handed me the folder and says, Mark, you're going to do the fake Mars program, I'd say, are you out of your mind? There's no way you can fake a program like that now. There's too many details, too many production techniques. You're going to get caught. Somebody's going to catch it, just like they did with every – and the moon missions have been torn apart, just shredded. The ISS is ridiculous right now. And Mars, whoever's got that job right now, no wonder they're dragging their feet, because it's just a mess. It's just a freaking mess. But well, I got you. And again, I don't know how much more time you have. I'm sorry.
I was going to say, I'm surprised we haven't been cut off for 10 minutes ago.
Well, the program's actually 3 hours. And obviously, we cut the breaks because I didn't want to interrupt at all.
I'm sorry.
No. Go ahead, Mark.
So you're it's okay to keep me up past my bedtime.
Well, no. Okay. Well, I want to keep you, but I do want to, because you're a radiation guy, I want to run this past you. Because this part's been bugging me, and people who know me, they know what I'm going to talk about here, and that is the Van Allen problem. And that was, if the Van Allen radiation belts, announced in 1959, were so horrible, deadly, and then Van Allen, you know, kind of pulls back from that and says, no, if we go real fast through them, that was his answer, let's just floor it, let's just hit the gas and go through it, there won't be any problem with it.
Well, I was looking at radiation problems in space way back, like in the early 60s, I guess.
Okay.
And people forget, there's a problem in the larger sense here of people using the term radiation to cover an awful lot of ground. There are charged particles that can't penetrate through anything. A piece of cardboard will shield you against those. Gamma rays, no way, Jose. Well, what the particulate radiation that's in, or the radiation that's in the Van Allen belts, if you're not there terribly long, and if you're in a, now you can't walk around without any clothes on, that would be difficult anyway, but then you'd get a lot of surface dose because there are plenty of particles that don't penetrate any distance. But if you're inside a craft in a uniform, and you may have noticed that they're not gossamer thin, the space uniforms, to say the least. And they're inside, let's say, aluminum can, for want of a better phrase. The radiation levels just aren't that high.
And
unless you spend all your time, doing floating around outside the spacecraft and in the belt instead of going through the belt.
Got it.
The radiation levels are not that high.
And I would, I'd take that, you know, for what it's worth. But there's a problem, and the problem is that NASA, October of last year, made a thing for television, and it's on their website right now. It's called Orion Trial by Fire. It's part of their Orion program, where they go into great detail about the Van Allen belts and saying how it's a big challenge, and they've still got to figure, and the first thing they're going to fire up there is going to be unmanned because they haven't figured out how to solve the radiation issue from the Van Allen belt. I do not know.
My God.
I do not know who decided to write that and put it on television. I do not know why it's still on their website. But, and I'm going to put, you know, I'm going to put that in a clip. You know, you can, anybody can watch it. It's on YouTube all over the place. It raises so many questions that it's like, okay, one, did they forget about how they supposedly solved the radiation issues from Apollo 8 to Apollo 17, the 10 missions? If they did forget, then why are they even trying it again? It just, there's too many things. It's like they want to get caught. It's so, this one was so dumbfounding.
We need more money to figure this out. That's usually the excuse.
Well, yeah, but it's not like, it's like everybody I showed this to said the same thing. It's like, wait, solve what? You already solved it 10 times, round trip. Nobody died.
I was going to say two times each trip, you know.
Yeah, yeah, nobody got radiation poisoning. Nobody died. The capsules weren't contaminated. So what exactly happened? And they still...
Well, you need neutrons to contaminate the capsules, and they... Where are the neutrons coming from? The Van Allen belts don't have neutrons.
Again, if the Van Allen belts aren't a threat, then why is NASA on their website? And again, this was made for television. They even, you know, brought out Kelly Smith, you know, their best and brightest. He was out there drawing on a clearboard, going into detail. You could not mistake it. What they were talking about. You know, they even made the radiation sounds and looked like, you know, the whole capsule was going to glow, and they were saying it's going to damage electronics, the guidance systems, and they wouldn't send people through it because it was too dangerous. So the question is, if it's too dangerous now, then what happened back in the 60s? And
yeah, somebody cranked up the engine, the Van Allen belt engine, of course.
Yeah. So that's, I mean, it leads into the stuff that we're looking at. If it, there's too many, again, that's just one of the questions we ask. And that is, okay, are the Van Allen belts real or are they not real? Because if they're not real, then at that point you have to, you know, then the whole entire space program, everybody's space program comes into question. So
well, the Van Allen belts are real. I'm convinced of that.
The hell?
And I'm also convinced that if you use good sense, you know, you don't walk outside when it's pouring rain and not expect to get wet.
Sure. Sure.
So I'd love to see that quote and see what.
Oh, I'll have Chris send you the link. If people want to look it up, it's on nasa.gov/press 2014 October. NASA premieres trial by fire video on Orion flight test. It's real easy to find. In fact, if you're just in Google, just type in Orion NASA trial by fire. You'll find it's still up there. I'm floored that it's still up there because it goes against everything that they talked about in the 60s. It just, they have no answer.
Well,
for
we talked about incompetence for NASA, so there we go.
Really?
Guys,
anyway,
let me jump in.
I don't know where that one came from. I'm shocked by that, but I shouldn't be, as I said. That meeting that I attended gave me a not very good view of NASA leadership and paying attention to doing things right. It was a sad day.
Let me jump in for just a moment. We have a listener that's called in from the chat room who's got a couple of questions, and he's been holding for about 45 minutes. So, let's go to him because he really wants to get his questions. I think we have Zach on with us. Are you there?
Yeah. Hey, how you guys doing? This is Zach from Portland, a.k.a. the proprietor. Just got a few questions for you. Originally, I had some different questions, but I figured I'd keep it kind of light. My first question is for Dr. Friedman.
Mister,
okay, sorry about that.
No doctor.
I'm not a doctor. Okay. Gotcha. So do you think water can bend?
Well, if it's in the form of ice, yes.
Oh, clever.
If it's in the form of ice. If it's a liquid form, do you think water can bend?
I don't know what that means when you say water bending.
I got, do you want me to?
Well, if we live on a ball and with all these oceans, that means water must be able to bend around a spinning ball. And I've spent about five months trying examples of this.
Sorry,
if it's attracted by gravity, that's putting it rather crudely, but what holds the water to the planet is gravity. So it's not bending. The flow is not in a straight line. You can see that in a river.
I understand that.
The water bends in that sense.
Well, how does gravity know? I mean, all the oceans are basically connected. So they weigh trillions and trillions of pounds. How does gravity decide how much to pull on, how much gravity to use to pull down towards the center of all these oceans versus just me or an apple falling from a tree? How does it distinguish that? How is that possible?
Well, the force of gravity is proportional to the mass of the attracting bodies. So if there's a big mass, it pulls harder. See, that's an awkward way of putting that. I wouldn't teach a class like that. But in other words, we do have a ball here. I guess that's the whole discussion, isn't it? We don't have a ball here. It's a flat plane. It's a flat Earth. But we do have, assume for a moment, a spherical body, roughly, flattened sphere, call it close to a sphere, good enough. The water is there. It is attracted by gravity. It's there not because it wants to be there. And so water, the mass of the water, it's maybe bent's a good word, maybe not. It's one of those questions that I don't see where it fits into the picture here. What if it's flat?
Well,
what holds it to the flat, to this flat surface?
Do you believe, well, what do you mean it's flat? When you pour water into a bowl, or say you pour water onto the concrete, it spreads out until it finds its flat level ground. Just like when you're trying to find your floor and you're doing construction, you use a level. Today's levels still use water in them because that is the most accurate form to find a level surface. I have a hard time. I've spent, 5 to 6 months trying to research how I can get water to bend around a spinning ball. And I have yet to find anyone who's done to prove this is true. I definitely agree it's a theory, but I just can't find anything.
Can I jump in for a second?
Sure.
I believe that if space was real, that a sphere might be able to hold water uniformly around it. However, that would be if the sphere wasn't spinning. Because if the sphere is spinning, then the centrifugal force should have some play on the liquid in question. So at that point, wouldn't we get bands of oceans? Wouldn't the oceans start to clump up towards the equator? Unless the gravity is so strong that it would actually completely counteract centrifugal force. So to your point, why do we have oceans on the North and South Pole on a globe if why do we have oceans there at all if the oceans should very quickly find their way, towards the point of centrifugal force?
There isn't an ocean at the South Pole. It's not an ocean. It's surrounded by ocean.
You know what I mean? I mean, the North Pole has an ocean. So,
yes.
But I see where he's going. I'm sorry. Anyway, I didn't mean to interrupt. What was your other thing?
That's okay. Another question I had is, you know, there's certain rivers on Earth that flow north to south, and a couple of these rivers are over 3,000 miles an hour. Now, if the curvature formula is correct,
3,000 miles long. He was just nervous.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I'm sorry about that. A little nervous. Those rivers should be flowing technically two directions. They should be, you know, but yet they're not. And I was just wondering, you know, kind of what you thought about that.
Hey, I know where there's a river that there's a place in St. John, New Brunswick, which has the reversing falls. The St. John River comes down and into the Bay of Fundy. But the tides in the Bay of Fundy are so high that when the tides go back the other way, the water goes up the falls, and they post the times when you can observe this happening, which sounds a little nuts, but it's true. I've been there. There is a reversing falls. The water goes backwards, if you want to call it that, up instead of down.
Yeah, I'll have to look into that.
Come visit St. John, New Brunswick.
Okay. What? I think it's the one I was talking about. I think it's called the Paraguay, and I think there's parts of the Nile that actually flow north and south that should, according to the curvature formula you were given, makes no sense whatsoever. You know, there should reach a point where it just all of a sudden, you know, you could just walk out into that river and just stand there, and you won't be tugged either way. Similar to like digging a hole down to China. Once you get halfway, you would just kind of stop right in the middle of the air and, you know, levitate. I kind of find that's strange.
That does sound strange to me too.
What else? What else you got?
The last question I had is, I spent a lot of time out at sea fishing, and lighthouses, I've seen them 60, 80, 90, sometimes 100 miles away. And I once again, with the curvature, is there any way you can explain to me how that's possible? I know you can say light bends, but, I've seen people at the base during the day. At the base of the lighthouse during the day, I shouldn't see somebody standing there because they're not bending. And that's 100 miles away, and I'm seeing them with, high-powered telescopes that are hooked to the side of the fishing boat. Do you know any reason, the magical reason, why I should be able to see that?
Nope, not particularly. The skies are clear. I don't know where you live. They're not that clear where I live.
Well, I think
100 miles is nothing out of 25,000 miles.
Right, but the rate of the curvature, and correct me if I'm wrong, Mark, but the way I'm understanding it, at 100 miles, we should have, I don't know what, like 1,800 feet of curvature?
At 100 miles, you can hear me?
Yes.
100 miles, it is, no, it's way more than that. 100 miles is 6,700 feet, so it's a mile and a quarter.
I'm having trouble with that. With the 25,000 mile circumference,
but
is only one part in 25.
But only an 8,000 mile radius. So
that's 20. It's over. It's what is the circumference of the Earth? Is what I'm saying.
Yeah, no, it's 25,000 miles around. But it doesn't matter because for this you really only care about radius. So, because if you go out roughly, it's 3,959, but we'll round it up to 4,000. Because once you get out 4,000 miles, it goes, if it's a sphere, then it goes completely vertical. So, yeah, it starts really shallow. So at 50 miles, it's only 1,700 feet, but at 100 miles, it's 7,000 feet. And it just gets getting worse to there until when you get at 4,000 miles, it becomes infinite. See? Kind of? Maybe?
I'll have to draw that out.
Okay. But again, it's not, you know, this isn't the flat earth math. This is straight from, you know, we just grabbed this out of a textbook. So it's but the point
experts
is, as
have been wrong too.
Well, of course, of course. And Wiki doesn't even, you know, it's funny because when you look up the curvature on Wiki, it only says 8 inches per mile, which is not true. That's just like stairs. That's just a slope. It has to get worse, you know, on a curve. But yeah, 8 inches per mile squared is generally what everyone's kind of, it took us a while to nail that down at the beginning, but that's what everyone kind of agrees at now.
I think we have Jonathan on with us, and he had a couple of questions.
Yeah, how you doing, guys?
Good.
Hey,
how
Jonathan.
Are you?
Good. I just want to, I'm sorry, I won't tax you like these gentlemen are, but I do want to thank you for the years of, I don't want to say entertainment, I want to say education, too. All the years you've been on air. But like yourself, I'd like to think I look at things with a more skeptical viewpoint and look for the science and sound logic and things. I may have worked with somebody you knew back in the day who worked for Bigelow, Dr. Bruce Cornett, when he used to go up to Pine Bush, New York.
Yes.
Okay. And so studying anomalies in the sky, you really have to do constant research. And even then, like you said before, when you guys turned it towards UFOs and space, you still can't definitively say what is it, right?
If you get an abduction case like the Betty and Barney Hill case, it's pretty clear what it is, you know, and especially when you got somebody like Dr. Benjamin Simon, who did the hypnosis work, 10 sessions each of two people separately, and you got the world-class expert on trying to recover shell shock war veterans, post-traumatic stress disorder, I guess, if we want to get fancy. Mm-hmm. But here's a guy who wrote the book. He ran a hospital with 3,000 beds for people who'd had war veterans, who had traumatic experiences. You know, your buddy's head gets blown off next to you. It's a little hard to recover easily from that experience. But Dr. Simon said with the Hills that the emotional intensity of their recounting of their experience under his controlled hypnosis was every bit as strong as that of the shell shock war veterans. Mm-hmm. And that, coming from him, that means something. From any dumb-dumb hypnotist, it doesn't mean anything. But coming from a guy who was in the movie, the Army made a movie, Let There Be Light, starring Benjamin Simon, about how he got people who'd had these, we're getting people coming back from Afghanistan and Iraq and so forth with PTSD these days. They used to die, but now they survive. But, you know, and so that one case, if no others, in other words, there's no question about what happened there is what I'm saying. I'm saying there are many sightings that you can't explain because you don't know what they are. You don't have enough data.
Right.
But you got 4,000 physical trace cases, and they get dull. And after you read the first 200 of people seeing something less than 100 yards away, it's on or near the ground, and after it leaves, you find physical changes, and it was a damn saucer-shaped craft, not always, but mostly. Then you've got something to work with. Lights in the sky don't move me at all, you know.
Right, right.
I really don't care about them. But the radar visual cases, and there are other good cases. So again, the question isn't, are all UFOs alien spacecraft? Of course not. The question is, are any? And the answer is yes. And, you know, it's like, the basketball coach knows that most people aren't 7 feet tall. Probably 99.5% people aren't 7 feet tall. He says, give me one. I don't care about the midgets. You know, so the one guy makes the difference. And so with UFOs, we've got a good solid base of data that the nasty, noisy negativists never talk about, which I find very fascinating, that part of it, too.
The reason I bring that up is because with your own research, if you just look in the past 200 years alone, right, the what you said earlier about NASA and about calling certain gentlemen liars, I personally think a lot of those men were men of integrity and they had a job to do, right? They had a mission. It was in a military capacity, NASA being, what, an extension of the Department of Navy, if that's correct?
No, it is not. NASA is not a military organization, supposedly.
But it has influence, no?
Oh, influence? Yeah, I suppose it does.
To my understanding, NASA is an arm of the Department of Defense.
No, it is not.
I didn't mean to upset you,
my faux pas. That was just my understanding. But if not, let's just say a lot of the men that were drawn for these programs, just like Mark had mentioned in The Right Stuff, they were test
pilots.
All
of the pilots, I think, had military pilot training.
Right. So in that sense, you know, they're carrying out a mission. They're not really there to speak on behalf of whether it's NASA or whatever. They understand the parameters of the mission. They're carrying them out. And what I'm getting at is NASA as an organization, if you look at the past 200 years of Earth's history, coming into really 1850, we supposedly went from the steam engine to Nikola Tesla to the nuclear age to computers and now nanotechnology. And for a certain...
That's all of them since 1900.
Right? Okay. So follow me here for a moment. With that, there's a great responsibility when you have the Earth's population going from 1 billion people in 1800 to the present 7-plus billion people. You have to not only manage resources, but if you're saying, and I'm not saying that you are, if anybody says that aliens are real or if the UFO abduction case is real or any of this, there's a greater responsibility to the societal whole of the world and keeping certain things secret until we've gotten to a level of sophistication like we are at now with computers and the internet and people waking up to possibly keeping these things on the wrap. Because look, if you remember, Orson Welles with The War of the Worlds. He did a simple radio broadcast and people lost it. Sci-fi movies, same thing.
Well, few people lost it. Look, I'm not saying there is a cover-up, and I have a whole chapter on the UFO why questions in Flying Saucers and Science.
Right.
And one of the big questions is why the cover-up? And I get five reasons for that, which makes sense to me anyway.
Right.
One is you want to figure out how the things work. Because they make wonderful weapons delivery and defense systems. And you got crash saucers, so you run good lab tests, but you can't tell your friends without telling your enemies. Second problem is, if the other guy figures out how they work before you do, how do you defend against them? You don't want them to know. You know. They know. You know. I mean, we've been playing this game for a very long time. But the third problem is maybe bigger. If you were to make an announcement that indeed planet Earth is being visited by intelligently controlled extraterrestrial spacecraft, what would happen? Church attendance would go up, mental hospital admissions would go up, the stock market would go down because anything that rocks the boat makes the stock market go down. But I think one of the biggest things that would happen, two things, the younger generation would start to think of themselves as an Earthling instead of all those nationalistic labels. And we live on a planet where nationalism is the only game in town. No government wants its citizens to owe their allegiance to the planet instead of that individual government. And governments are very defensive. We're spending $1 trillion this year on things military.
Not even the UN with a flat Earth map, right? That's their logo.
No. I mean, $1 trillion is a lot of dough. Where I come from anyway. There are other reasons. The fundamentalists would be very upset because, as I said, they said that all the intelligent life in the universe is right on, at least in the galaxy, is right on planet Earth. And this UFO work is the work of the devil, they say.
I want to say one more thing, and again, I know I didn't want to tax you, but I agree with a lot of what you said tonight, one of which was your explanation or your brief summary of gravity, and you kind of chuckled at that. You didn't want to go into it. I think you know Tesla didn't refer to it as gravity, but density. And so when people talk about the curvature of water or water bending, I have to tell them this. Now, I've seen these arguments made in the flat Earth movement, but that people are basing their logic on being on terra firma, on flat land. Whereas water has a certain density that as you go down in fathoms, you sink, right? Just like a heavy weight. If you tie it around your ankle or a cement block, you'll sink deeper and deeper into the ocean. So water kind of bends, if you want to say that, or curves and forms to whatever the container it's in. That's all I'm going to say there as far as the curvature goes. It's not on flat level ground as it reaches out to the horizon. The ocean is not flat in that sense. And so I'm just going from the model that where Tesla called gravity density in his explanation. That's all I'm going to say there.
I didn't know that. That's interesting. Tesla was a genius. Of course, he remember the famous question, where's the meter going to go? When Tesla talked about getting free electricity. And J.P. Morgan, who was supporting some of his research, asked that little question, where's the meter going to go? And if there wasn't, and if you're going to make it free, he didn't want any part of it.
Well, if I could just tax you, if I could tax you with one question, if I could just ask that you do possibly check out Mark Sargent's Flat Clues, because I think he puts it more concisely and eloquently, and I think somebody like yourself is very necessary and needed at this juncture in the Flat Earth movement, because I think you can bring some sound logic to it and you know, say this is very accurate and this is kind of, you know, this needs more examination. So thank you for coming on tonight. I'm gonna give you guys back to each other.
15 more minutes.
You don't have to keep them. Seriously, I feel bad because I'm on the West Coast.
Thank you for your
questions.
Yeah,
I'm on the Atlantic time zone.
I know.
Yeah,
nobody is in the Atlantic time zone. You're the only person I've ever known to actually be there.
Well, everything east of Maine is in the Atlantic time zone. Look, if you want a strange time zone, you go to Newfoundland, and they're a half hour ahead of us.
Ooh, that's creepy.
Well, that's the way it is. I'm sorry.
Is there a name for it?
Atlantic time zone.
No. Half an hour ahead of you. It's still just Atlantic?
No, you're right. It's Newfoundland time.
Newfoundland time. Okay.
You know, I noticed that in Australia, too, while I was programming some stuff. They have a time zone that's 30 minutes ahead, which is weird. How do you account for that? But anyways, let's wrap it up since we do only have actually, we only have about 10 minutes left because the broadcast ends at the 57. So, Mark, what would you like to leave the audience with?
Check it out. You know, it's a very polarizing discussion. I don't expect anybody to get it in a day. You can either Google Flat Earth Clues or just go to YouTube and type in Flat Earth. It doesn't have to be my stuff, although my stuff is a pretty good introduction to it. And, you know, I enjoyed the debate very, very much, or discussion or whatever you want to call it, with Stanton. Thank you. Thank you. I couldn't have dreamed that I would have been doing a debate like this 10 months ago.
I think it was fantastic, and I wouldn't even call it a debate. It's definitely a discussion, and I hope that it didn't disappoint people out there. I think people were expecting boxing gloves in all of this, but we really need to sit down and put our heads together. I mean, that's what it's about. It's about putting confirmation bias to the side and finding the truth and philosophizing and all of that. Stanton, what are your thoughts so far? Are you going to research the Flat Earth topic now?
Well, I'm going to look some more, so the next time I'll have killer arguments.
But they raise some pretty good points, I should say. I mean, you know, a lot of people think it's just a bunch of idiots who just fall for anything, but there's really some valid points that are being made.
I was intrigued in looking up some historical stuff, realizing I hadn't realized that long before Columbus, it was widely assumed that the Earth was round, a sphere. And some guys measured the measurements. Some guy measured it 2,000 years ago or more. But Columbus, unfortunately, didn't have the right measurements, and he didn't have enough vittles to get him any further. It's a good thing he ran into a continent. So I was intrigued with that, which I didn't know. And there were strong religious arguments dealing with this subject, which I hadn't been aware of. What I want to leave people with is the need for polite discussion, which we've had tonight, I think.
Yeah.
Because we disagree doesn't mean we need to be disagreeable. And for anybody who's interested more about UFOs, I would give my website, www.stantonfriedman.com, because it lists my books, which when I send out are all autographed, which you can't get from Amazon. And if any of the people listening are insiders on the UFO scene, military guys who know about stuff that happened that nobody's talked about, and, you know, my website has my email address, and I'm not soliciting violations of national security. But you got any stories to tell, I'd like to listen to them. Some people have are none of the original Roswell witnesses, as far as I know, are still alive. But some of them may have left pieces of wreckage to their grandkids. And so I'd like to hear about them, if there's anybody out there. It would be nice to have a piece of something to take to a lab of my choosing and get tests run. And so there's more to the story. The UFO story is a big story, and it has to do with a lot of things, just as this flat Earth thing does, about not just facts and data, but what does it mean? What are the implications? And certainly there are implications for religion and for politics, if you will. When is this? How can we get this planet not to spend $1 trillion on things military, because of all the warfare, the added, the hate, the, you know, let's kill the other guy. I try to put myself in the place of aliens looking at this planet, and the simplest description I can give is a primitive society whose major activity is tribal warfare. A lot of kids died of starvation yesterday and the day before that. And we're spending $1 trillion on things military. That bothers the heck out of me. I have a great grandson. I'd like him to grow up in a peaceful world. Sure doesn't look like it right now. That's my message for the night.
Wow, that's beautiful. And that's the goals of Truth Frequency Radio as well. We hope to leave this place in a better place. That we found in a better state that we found it, whether it's flat or a globe or a dome or any of this. And if it is a dome, that's all the more reason to make sure that this place is kept in the best possible state, because we only have one. And I had these two fish. They were Oscar fish, and they were actually a little smarter than most fish. They would recognize me, but when I would walk by, and they would start picking up rocks and throwing it at the glass to try to get my attention when they wanted something to eat. It was amazing. But when I would leave, they would tear up all of the air, all of the air tubes. They would uproot the plants. They would make a complete mess of it. And I would go in there almost every night and put everything back together. But it seems like that's what we're doing to our fishbowl. We keep uprooting all the plants. We keep tearing up the air system and everything. And we're going to see our demise if we don't get it together.
You're right.
That is what it's all about.
Interesting evening.
It has been, definitely. So again, thank you very much for your time this evening, Stanton. And any new work in progress?
Yeah, Kathleen Martin and I are working on another book. I can't tell you the details about it, but should have it in 6 months.
Is it a matter of national security?
No, but publishers don't want us to talk about it.
Oh, I understand.
You got to do what your publisher says, or he won't publish it.
That sounds kind of like Flat Club. First rule is you don't talk about Flat Club.
Well, what can I say? I'm an optimist. We'll get the book out, and then we can talk about it. It'll make some people angry.
Excellent. Well, when it comes out, let's have you on the broadcast for sure.
Okay.
Excellent.
Good show.
Thanks for your time. Have a great evening.
Thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen,
night, Mark.
No, hey, night, Stanton. Nice talking to you.
Thank you very much for tuning in this evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are just about at the end of the broadcast, about 4 minutes left, and I think that was great.
I thought it was great, too.
Yeah, the back and forth was amazing. It turned out way better than I thought it would.
Yeah, me too. It wasn't just educational and informational. It was also a lot of fun. So I think everybody had a lot of fun.
Right, definitely. Yeah. So what's coming up on Strange World?
We're going to probably pre-record it, because I've got a Jimmy Church interview on, excuse me, my voice is a little hoarse now, on Tuesday.
Oh, do you? Okay.
Yeah. So I don't know. I don't know what we're going to do, but I'm always looking for, like Stanton was reaching out, I'm always looking for people to come forward, especially in the professional sector, the military sector, anybody who wants to come out and talk about, even if we've already talked about the subject, you know, another pilot, another Navy guy, another Army guy, you know, I'll take all comers. So
excellent. And Jonathan, what's coming up on Perceptions?
Perceptions. I was thinking of doing a Christmas call-in show because it falls that night. I'm not celebrating anything special. I do want to have an end of the year, predictions show. I didn't know if Mark was going to do the same or do something, but it'd be interesting to hear people's predictions for 2016.
I'll do it.
Really? I would have thought you celebrated Hanukkah.
No, Festivus, actually, on the 22nd. I got to set the Festivus poll.
Festivus for the rest of us.
Excellent. Nice. Excellent. You know, what I've realized lately, and, you know, what are your thoughts on this, Mark, is that it really doesn't matter whether it's flat or a globe. What matters is the fact that people are elevating their consciousness to the point to where they're questioning it. And
yeah.
That, I think, just speaks just volumes for the human species.
Agreed. We still don't know exactly what the map looks like, you know, exactly. And it's when I kind of talked about this in the beginning, where the enthusiasm from all these different camps, it's like, no, it's this. No, it's this. That shows you the level of intensity that's getting behind this. It's, yeah, you're absolutely right. It's not that we know we're trying to define it, but nobody knows exactly how to define it yet. So it's the whole Monty Python Life of Brian thing, when Brian drops his shoe and everybody's trying to define the meaning of the dropping of the shoe. That's what everyone's doing here. But you're right. People are elevating. They're waking up to this wherever we are. Call it the 100th monkey effect or the million human effect. It's real. It's happening. It is not going away. And I love the debates at this point.
That's what it's all about. So, ladies and gentlemen, kiss the one you love right now. You never know when the last time is going to be. Into the darkness, we will continue to bear the light right here on truthfrequencyradio.com. Your protection from deception.
Love you guys. We'll see you next week.
With the renegades, castaways, outlaws to the game like Thomas Paine was. They masquerade us. To blame us now, set to explode like a hand grenade does. No peace to seize the police to show peace, unleash beef, no relief, peace underneath the beast.